Hey everybody, Reed here. Welcome to another installment of the Video Power Rankings. Today I'm covering the standard format, fresh off the banning of the Meat Hook Massacre. Black decks are still really strong. You're going to see them well represented on the top 10 list this week, but I do think the banning moved the needle, freed up some space for other archetypes to do well, and we do have a bit of variety. So let's get into it. Coming in at number 10 is White Weenie, Mono White Aggro. This is a deck that I've enjoyed when I've played with it myself, and it's a huge, huge winner from the banning of the Meat Hook Massacre. You know, possibly the single archetype that benefits the most from that card not being in the format, and frankly, board sweepers not being widely played in folks' main decks anymore. So, Hopeful Initiate, Thalia, Guardian of Thraben, Adeline, Resplendent Cathar, and the Wandering Emperor. These are sort of known quantities that have been extremely powerful and standard. They've been around. And then add to that Anointed Peacekeeper, which has really overperformed my expectations and been a great card. And you have just a nice, solid, consistent, punishing, and disruptive, aggressive deck. I recommend this as a sort of entry point if you're new to standard or just looking for a deck that's very straightforward and easy to understand. Number 9, we have another white deck. White is a pretty strong color in standard right now, which is not something that you could have said at every point in the last handful of years, but a lot of really good white cards, and this is another way to make use of them. This is Invoke Justice. So the key card here, Invoke Justice, reanimates a permanent, not only a creature, so you're almost always going to look down and have a nice target for Invoke Justice. While you're at it, you get to distribute 4+1+1 counters. Now that's not a little cherry on top. That's not a small bonus. That is a massive board presence swing. And if you can actually invoke justice, a powerful card like a Sanctuary Warden or an AO of the Dawn Sky, that's going to give you such an overwhelming advantage potentially so early in the game that you're going to pick up some easy wins. Now you can discard your best reanimation targets via Fable of the Mirror Breaker, Restoration of Igonjo, Connive abilities. Sometimes this deck has the Elder Dragon War, but I really like this strategy as well, and a great way to build sort of a non-black mid-range deck or a deck that has powerful sequences to access later on in the game. Number 8, first of many black mid-range decks that are going to make the top 10 list this week, but it is Rakdos Mid-Range. I like this deck in its sort of simplicity, its card quality, just very clean, good mana base, and you're going to be curving stuff like Duress and Cutdown into Fable of the Mirror Breaker, Graveyard Trespasser, Shouldred the Apocalypse, and this particular version that I've chosen to highlight has Invoke Despair, which is one of the best top-end options available. So, not much to say that I won't be able to say about a lot of the other decks on this list, but Rakdos just has access to great removal and disruption, and very, very high card quality, difficult to attack. Number 7, Domain. So in a format with many mid-range decks, there's an appeal of going big. In this case, very, very, very big, with 4 copies each of Herd Migration and the Kami War. You're using Llanowar Loamspeaker and the Celestis to get to that point. Leyline Binding as an undercosted spell. Not like you're going to cast this on turn 1, but in practice, this deck has turns in the mid-game where maybe you lose out on tempo in the early turns playing tapped lands or investing in these mana ramp cards. But then on turn 4 or 5, you double spell with like a Workshop War Chief, leaving up 1 mana for Leyline Binding to protect yourself in combat, really swing the game, and then drop the hammer with the Kami War or Herd Migration. Very fun deck, very powerful. Give it a try if that's a strategy that appeals to you. All right, number 6. Yet another way to use the white cards in standard. This is mono white control or mono white mid-range. So it almost in some ways looks like a post sideboard configuration of the white weenie deck. You're still going to see creature based options, Ambitious Farmhand, Anointed Peacekeeper, Wedding Announcement, but we're going much bigger to take advantage of more Planeswalkers, Sarah Paragon. And this deck actually has different and potentially more powerful removal options. Vanquish the Horde, March of Otherworldly Light, Farewell in the sideboard, which is a really powerful card that not every archetype can access right now. But mono white midrange, a surprising archetype. This isn't going to exist in every format, but right now, sort of the sweet spot where this deck has excellent card quality, answers to everything. The format lends itself to these like powerful late game decks. And yeah, Mono White has just impressed me. Number five, another very unusual strategy that's not going to exist in every format. This is Mono Blue. So the idea here is to load up on card drawing and counterspells. Counterspells particularly good in Standard because it is so much about who can resolve the most powerful card. You know, big Planeswalkers, Invoke Despair. We saw that deck with the Kami War and Herd Migration. Counterspells are going to be basically the only way to reliably beat a strategy like that. So a lot of nice qualities about a deck that can pass every turn with mana open and sort of never put the shields down. Now top that off with a couple of uniquely potent blue threats that can win the game all on their own. Insectile Aberration, Haughty Djinn, and Talarian Terror. And you actually have a strategy that's performs better than it looks. So I'd keep an eye on Mono Blue. It's not just a gimmick deck. Number four, getting into sort of rarefied air. These are the decks that I would expect to see every time I enter a standard queue, a standard tournament, whatever it might be. These are the ones you really want to have a good plan against. This is Grixis. This particular version that I've chosen to highlight has no Blood Tithe Harvesters, but that's a little bit unusual. This caps out Invoke Despair. Really, the point that I want to drive home is that this is a really good color combination for brewing. You sort of get the solid Grixis mana base supported by Xander's Lounge. You have great removal and disruption options, and then just fill in the rest with the cards you like. There's no shortage of great options for like card advantage, threats. You could choose to play more Planeswalkers. You could choose to play a vampire theme, whatever it might be. Grixis is just very strong and well-rounded. Number three, Jund Reanimator. It's another way to sort of go over the top in mid-range matchups, but maybe not as clunky or one-dimensional as something like the Domain deck. Instead, this is a nice Jund mid-range deck with, you know, removal spells, duress in the sideboard, nice balanced mana curve, but you have this late game powerful engine built in where you're looking to either just cast Titan of Industry or reanimate it quickly off the Cruelty of Gix. So in practice, this deck's going to just be sort of playing a normal mid-range game, jockeying for position, getting value. You can play Cruelty of Gix on chapter one if you just want to get three card advantage modes on back-to-back-to-back turns. Soul of Windgrace can get you some value and get you to your top-end spells ahead of schedule. But then also, sometimes you're just going to have these great draws where, boom, Cruelty of Gix reanimating Titan of Industry as early as turn four, stabilizing your position against aggro or other mid-range decks and just punishing anyone who sort of underestimates you or puts the shields down. Now, I'm really happy this week because that's not the only Jund deck that appears on the list. Both the number three and the number two position are both different takes on the Jund color combination. This one is just classic Jund midrange, just the same way it exists in a lot of formats. Card quality, mana curve, solid standalone threats, great removal. Classic Jund midrange actually won both of the Magic Online challenges this weekend. So first weekend off of the Meat Hook Massacre ban, we still have Jund putting up great numbers and really driving home the fact that this is one of the top strategies in Standard. But arguably not the top strategy, because today the number one position is going to Esper midrange, the same deck that I ranked number one right before the banning of the Massacre. You really just can't beat Esper in terms of card quality, well-roundedness, sideboard options. Just like I said about Grixis, you can really customize within the Esper color combination. I think the main question you want to ask yourself when you build Esper is how much you want to be tapping out for powerful proactive cards like Raphine and Shouldred versus how much do you want to be holding up mana and playing sort of a flash reactive game with stuff like Make Disappear, Urtai Resurrected, The Wandering Emperor. I've seen folks with Spell Pierce, Cathar Commando. So yeah, I mean, Esper is just very difficult to play against. Not for many reasons, not the least of which is that there's just so many cards that they could throw at you. You know, one player's going to have AO the Dawn Sky, one's going to have main deck depopulate, one's going to have all these great permission spells, Obscura Interceptor, and you just don't really know all the time unless you're playing an open decklist tournament. Even then, there's a lot of guesswork to be doing, and you know, a lot of sideboard options and options for the Esper player to change their configuration to make it tough on you. So this remains the number one deck. Still have to say Black Midrange is looking great in standard, but I do think the Meat Hook Massacre ban opened up the door, did a little bit of work towards balancing things, and yeah, I'm having fun with standard. I hope you are too. Let me know in the comments if you think I missed anything or what decks you expect to sort of pick up steam in the coming weeks. That's all I've got for today. Bye, everyone.